Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Good morning. Welcome to Morning Cup of Jesus. I'm your host, Minister Edward Broom. It's a blessed day without any more delay. Let's get started, shall we? Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Father God in heaven, it's in Jesus' name. It's in Jesus' name I want to say thank you, God. Thank you for another day, Lord God. Thank you for putting me to sleep last night and giving me rest in the name of Jesus. Thank you for waking me up this morning, Lord God, and setting me on the right path, Lord God. God, it seems that the song that was in my mind, Lord, not a usual or normal song that I would be thinking, Lord God, but the song still goes, Lord God, with the word that you have given me, have given us this morning, God. I pray, Lord God, that I would speak what you want the people to hear. I pray, Lord, that you would use me as the vessel that you put the word in, the conduit that you use to get the word to the people. And God, use me as the messenger who delivers your word, God. Use me, God. I'm at your disposal, Lord God. Use me at your discretion, but I'm also at your mercy, Lord God. Have mercy on me. Have mercy on us all, Lord God, and help us to understand what you're saying and what your will is, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Now, God in heaven, I can't thank you enough for all the things you've been doing, Lord. And God, I pray for forgiveness when I complain about things, neglecting to be reminded of the things you've already done, Lord. Whether I complain verbally or whether I complain in my heart, Lord God, I repent. And I hope that, God, you know that I and we all, we appreciate everything you do, Lord God, the good and the bad, through the thick and the thin, the ups and the downs, Lord God. So have your way in us. Have your way this morning, Lord God. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. All right, today's scripture is coming from Hebrews chapter 9. Just two little verses. Hebrews chapter 9, verse... Oh, I didn't do that thing there. Hold on, let me change this thing. Window capture, delete. Hebrews chapter 9, verses 27 through 28. There we go. It says, "And as it is appointed for men to die once, but after this, the judgment, so Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time, apart from sin, for for salvation. May the Lord bless the readers, hearers, and the doers of his holy word. Man, now the song that I woke up with a song on my heart. Now it wasn't a gospel song, and it wasn't a Christian song. You know, if I was to try to listen to it, you know, I would have to find a clean version of it, because I know, like in the first couple verses, songs by a guy named T.I. I know and T.I. and Jamie Foxx. I think Jamie Foxx was singing at one point in time. Jamie Foxx was singing on everybody's music because he had bought a studio and stuff like that. But I would have to edit. I would have to listen to the clean version of the song, because a couple bars in the T.I.'s rap verse, he started cussing stuff, and that stuff really don't resonate with my spirit, man. I don't be wanting to hear a lot of cussing. You know, I don't. You know, we watching a movie and hearing some. We started watching some movie with Snoop Dogg and teaching football. Or coaching football or doing something. I was like, it seemed like it's gonna be a pretty funny movie. Snoop Dogg was a former football player, hurt himself and he retired or something. But as soon as it come on, he going all off the rip, cussing the little kids and saying, I said, Misha, let's just watch something else. It was my idea to watch the movie, because I like movies. You know, it seemed fun. I watched over with cussing and killing and sex and drugs and all that in it. But it just, that was just too much for me. When it started, it was just too much to my ears. My spirit won't allow me to sit there and listen to it in the first 5 minutes. You know what I'm saying? 4 minutes worth of cussing and stuff. So I just knew. And so therefore, I can't really, if there's a message in a song that's not a Christian song and it's got a lot of vulgar language in it, you know, a lot of cussing words, I can't hear what's going on. You know, and this song here, it's not a Christian song. It's called Live in the Sky. He was saying, when you die, you have to live in the sky. That's the song that I woke up and this song was playing. You know, I wasn't thinking about it yesterday or any other time. I wasn't thinking about T.I. and Jamie Foxx and none of that stuff. Now, it could have been because I was thinking of life's ups and downs. That's what the singer says, life's ups and downs, they come and go. Then the other guy say, when we die, I hope to live in the sky. Well, he said, all my folks remain alive. I hope they live in the sky. Tell God when I die, I want to live in the sky. And he said a few more things. But that's what was on my mind. That was on my heart when I woke up this morning. And the scripture is this right here, Hebrews chapter 9. But now the scripture that they came up with, it was more than two verses. It stopped at 28, the end of 28, verse 28 is the last verse of chapter 9 in Hebrews. Hebrews 9, 28 is the last verse in that chapter. And I think it started at 23 or somewhere. I read, I said, I can't understand this stuff to teach it right now. This ain't a quick read it and talk about it. I'm not a read something and talk about it type of person. I got to study and see what it says, what it, you know, and it had too much Old Testament revelation being revealed in the New Testament. It was too much caught up in there to try to squeeze it all into a text message. Just the last two verses is enough for a morning scripture, and so that's what I decided to do. I haven't studied the book of Hebrews too deep. You know, maybe chapter 11 is a good chapter we study. Chapter 11, then chapter 12 is also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. I think I made chapter 6, where it talks about those who have tasted the Lord Jesus Christ and know about him and know his goodness, and they've tasted the Holy Spirit. It's impossible for them to go back to the Lord if they tasted the Lord and then turn their back away and go, you know, and so it's impossible for them to come back. But in actuality, once we taste the Lord and know that the Lord is real and experience his Holy Spirit, we don't turn away from the Lord. We might go and commit sin, but we never turn away from the Lord because it's too real, you know? And so, yeah, so I haven't done an in-depth study about on Hebrews chapter 9 or any Hebrews or most of Hebrews for that matter. But listen, I know this, though. This is what I said. And I believe the Lord showed me this scripture this morning, because I said somebody yesterday or the day before. When I said you only get to die one time, here is the scripture. The Lord showed me, here is the verse right here. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, right? Or 28. Verse 27. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. So when the Lord God Almighty takes away the breath of life from you, you are dead, and there is no doctor or machine that can bring you back to life. When people testify that they died and came back, they are crediting the doctors and the machines with giving them life. No, God gave you the breath of life, and when he removes the breath of life from you, no doctor, no machine, nothing can bring you back to life. If somebody be in a coma for 10 years, and then on a breathing machine for 10 years, and then they open their eyes and come out of their coma, God never took the breath of life away from them. You know what I'm saying? He didn't take their life away from them and condemn them to death. He didn't kill them off right then. He didn't allow them to die right. It's just for the sensitive people who say that God don't kill us. He didn't allow them to die then. Now, mind I mind you, Jesus took the keys to death. Jesus has the keys to death. So if anybody gonna take you, gonna kill you, it's Jesus. You know, if anybody gonna allow you to live, it's Jesus. If anybody gonna allow you to die, it's Jesus. The devil does not choose when you die. Jesus has that power, and he took the keys of death when he went down out there. That's what the Bible says. The Bible says Christ Jesus, when he took the keys to death, and he got the key to the pit. Jesus got a key to everything. You know what I'm saying? He is the way, the truth, and the life, because he has all the keys. He is the master key, you know? And so when people say testify, or you know, when I say testify, I don't mean stand up in church. I just mean they bear witness that this took place. They're saying that God killed me, but the doctor brought me back. Or God killed me and I was dead, but he changed his mind and brought me back to life. Huh? You know what I'm saying? Now, there were people in the Bible who God allowed to pass, and he brought them back to life. But he got the credit for that, not the doctors, not the machine, not the prophet. You know, it was all a credit to God. God did it. He worked through people's hands and all that. Now, God can work through a machine to save somebody. He can work through a doctor to save somebody. But I think that when we say we died 9 times and came back to life 9 times, because your heart stopped beating, you were not dead. You know, when they declare you legally dead, and some people, I've been watching medical shows. Somebody was down in the morgue in the hospital. They were declared dead, and somebody was checking something in them, and when they shine the light across the eye, the pupil didn't do whatever it does for dead people. And somebody said, "This man's still alive down in the morgue." You know, his body wasn't moving. It seemed like there was no breath in his body, but he had a medical condition that caused his body to be completely still, and there was still brain activity. Whatever the guy checked it, there was still brain activity. Whatever the guy checked on the so-called dead guy, there was still brain activity and stuff. So they took him upstairs and did whatever they had to do, and the guy was alive. You know what I'm saying? And so I say that to say this: God is the one who determines when we die. And God is not confused about the day that you die. Right now today, God knows the day that I'm going to die. He's not confused. He's not going to get all the way up to that day and say, "Oh man, I got something else I wanted to do. Let me bring him back to life and let him live again." When Lazarus died in Hebrew, I mean, not Hebrew, in Matt, John chapter 11. I couldn't say Matthew. John chapter 11 is when I'm going to make sure I'm saying the right thing. Yeah, John chapter 11. When Lazarus died, Jesus already said this: him dying is not unto death. Jesus was saying he's not really dead. He's just sleeping. Oh, thank you, Lord. That's what you can say. He said, "Well, I fell asleep 9 times on the table, but the Lord didn't see fit that it was my time to die." That, and no, I know I got such a way with words. Words might not make a big deal, but to me, you know what I'm saying? I say when you say something to somebody, it don't really mean anything. But I guess conversely, if you're saying something that's untrue, it means something. If you're telling a lie, that means something. If you're saying giving some wrong information, that means something to me. I think actions speak louder than words, but I think when you're saying something that's not true, that speaks loud as well. You know what I'm saying? Or when you talking about God, or when you giving credit to somebody, those words speak loud. Now, I also, and I can't really, I'm not contradicting how I feel about it. Words don't mean a whole lot to me when you're talking about loving. You love me, or showing me something, or love anybody, or showing them something through your words. To me, that don't mean a whole lot. I think your actions need to show your love. But if you're telling a testimony or telling a lie, I think your words mean a whole lot, because it determines if you are, or if you are true, or if you are being false. You know what I'm saying? To that extent. And so, according to the scriptures, we all get one life to live, and then we have an appointment with God to be judged. Maybe you fall asleep. Maybe, like Jesus said about Lazarus, Lazarus just sleeping, man. He ain't dead. Lazarus is just Lazarus. And people say they died and they saw certain people in hell, certain people in heaven. Doing, they said they was in hell or heaven, this and that, this and that. You know what I'm saying? That's what people testify of. That's what they say. I died. I saw him in heaven. I saw her in heaven. I saw him in hell. I saw her and him in heaven. This and that, man. And so, I just think that when we all get one life to live, then after you die, once you die, you'll have an appointment with God for judgment. Why do I believe that? Because the Bible says that. I don't believe what some person says. I don't care. Well, I don't they if they come and say, "Man, look, God, I saw God when I died last night, and they brought me back to life on the table. God told me later on today, you're gonna be walking, you're gonna and then a red car gonna have a wreck right there in front of you, and then you're gonna go walk into a building, and then this person gonna say that." This and that and this and then it's gonna happen. And they tell me a few things that God told them gonna happen to me that day or something. I said, wow, how that man know all these things are gonna happen to me today? And he's a random person. Maybe that was the truth. Maybe he did die and God showed him that. I have to believe what he told me is true. If he tell me three, four things is about to happen later on today to me, specific things, and he said, I died and God told me these things were going to happen. But that's never going to be the case with anybody on this earth. Nobody on this earth gives a 100% revelation. They probably used to do it in the days, but now it's just, I'm a prophet. God said you're going to prosper. What does that even mean? You know what I'm saying? I'm a prophet. God says you're going to have a house. You're not going to rent all your life. You're going to have a house. What? God says you're going to have a car. Stuff like that, man. And so I just don't believe all the hype about I died and I can't, and I saw this and saw that, then I came back to life, because I can't prove this the truth. And we should not place our faith in other things or other people besides the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't say this man died, he came back, he must be telling the truth, and place your faith in him. Now if he and now, oh, thank you, Jesus. I gotta back up my words here. Now, those who are saved, they're gonna know that the Antichrist, the beast, the deceiver, is gonna be able to work signs and miracles. And he might be able to tell you tomorrow, somebody gonna pull up to your house at 7 a.m. in a red car. And then they're gonna come give you a piece of mail, and the piece of mail is gonna say this. You know what I'm saying? He might go and put it in somebody and give them a red card, give them a letter to deceive you into believing that he's the truth, just to get you to follow whatever he's saying or whatever he's doing. And the scripture says even the elect are gonna be deceived if he can deceive them. So I take back what I'm saying about if somebody tell me three, four things gonna happen to me today, and they're specific, and those things happen. I still have to use discernment to judge whether whether this person is trying to get me to follow the things of the Word of God, or what he's trying to get me to follow things that are not the Word of God. Because see, when they work the signs, it's to get you to believe that they are telling the truth. And if what you believe is the Holy Bible, if you believe in the Holy Bible, that you believe the Bible is the truth, and those people can work a miracle and get you to follow them, then they'll tell you the Bible is a lie. And the Lord God Almighty warns us about this in the Old Testament. He says, if a person comes to you and tells you a prophecy, he gives you a prophecy, and that prophecy comes to pass, that prophecy does happen, it does take place, and then that same old person who gave you the prophecy before it took place and it really happened in real life, and that person tell you to follow other gods, don't do it. See, that he tells us this, if God says don't do it, because he knows it's going to happen. He knows somebody gonna say, yeah, man, next week you're gonna get a phone call at 7 o'clock in the morning, you're gonna get a new job, and then the next day somebody gonna come to you with you're gonna find a car online for this amount of money, and you're gonna buy it, and everything gonna be good. And then the next week after that, you're gonna meet a woman and she's gonna be wearing this, and then you're gonna love her. And all those things happen just the way the prophet said it. God said, even if those things do come to pass, and that prophet tell you to follow after false gods or other gods besides the God, Lord God Almighty, don't believe him. See, don't believe him. So I retract that statement saying if somebody told me three, and I keep on, I'm making such small predictions or prophecies. These are small. I don't try to think of something so dramatic or something so significant that a person will place their faith in the other person. You know what I'm saying? You know, I don't know. My mind ain't even working on it. I need to work, stay on this right here. And so if somebody do tell you something that come to pass, don't believe them. If they're trying to tell you they're telling you to go against the Word of God instead of with the Word of God. Same way, don't believe somebody say they died and came back and this person or that person was in heaven or hell. And you accredit them to being a prophet or something. Because once God take your life, the breath of life away from you, you're gone for good. You're dead. There's no coming back. And the Bible says we die one time, and then we have to be judged by God. All right? So according to the scripture, we get one life, then we have an appointment with God to be judged. Then we move on to our eternal life with him in paradise, while others go to their eternal place of torment. That's the truth. That's what the Bible says. So why is it so harsh? Why is it so critical? Why do some people go one way and others go the other way? Haven't we all sinned? Haven't we all fallen short of God's glory? Aren't we all terrible people and have a sinful nature? Yes. But why do some go one way and some go the other way? Isn't it the same God who gives us the heart to go after him? Isn't the same God who puts more burdens on other people to break them down and cause them to surrender to him? Yes. But our sins must be atoned for. That's why some people go one way and some people go the other way. God knows the hearts of everybody, and he knows that we all have sins, but our sins must be atoned for. Whoever has Jesus, the Lord imputes no sin to him. Whoever has the Lord Jesus, the Lord imputes no sin to him. And that's why we go into eternal life, paradise with God, because we have Jesus Christ. And the others go because they don't have Jesus. Whoever has the Lord Jesus, God imputes no sin to him because Jesus has taken away their burden. The others must pay for their sin. They must pay since they don't need Jesus to pay for them. That's why they go. And people say, well, what about doing being a good person, living a good life, doing good, and then not believing in Jesus, but you live out the commandment? There's the Jesus effect. You are, all of us have sinned. They have some notion that they can go through life without sin. Now, if you go through life and you know you sin, and you say, yeah, I sin, I can just pray for forgiveness, you got to start right there. If you're praying for forgiveness, who are you praying for? Who are you praying to for forgiveness? If you're praying to God, You can't get to God without Jesus. They try to skip through Jesus. They try to skip through the Word of God. They try to skip the Holy Bible, the commands. They just say Jesus is not the way. Jesus ain't the one. And so, because they don't have their sins atoned for by Jesus, they must pay for their own sins. And the wages of sin is death. There's no other wages for sin. There can be punishment and consequences for your sin in this lifetime, but the wages of your sin is death and eternal separation from God. If you don't have Jesus to pay for those sins, you are going to be paid death for your sins. Bottom line, Jesus already got paid death for your sins. Why not just lay all the burden on him? Why not live for him? Why not live with him? Why not live through him? You know what I'm saying? Why try to live for yourself? Live for the world. Live for this. Live for that. Live for him. Live for her. Knowing that those people are not following Jesus Christ. You know, if you're going to follow somebody who's following Jesus Christ. Paul says, follow me as I follow Christ. You better follow Jesus or follow somebody who's following Jesus or both. If you following Jesus and you got all these people going to Jesus and you get lost on what you're supposed to do, you grab on that person and talk to him and say, hey, man, I don't understand how this works right here, but it looks like you're going in the right. Are you going toward Jesus and you're not stumbling. You're not walking slow. You're not confused. Oh, thank you, Lord. Sometimes I'm moving real fast because I know what I'm headed to go do. When I'm working, I know I've already figured out the plan. I've already figured out what I'm going to do, how I'm going to do it. I got tools, or I got a plan put together, so I'm walking fast. I'm heading the way I'm going to get something done, get the job done. But when I don't know exactly what I'm about to do, when I'm trying to figure out the plan, when I'm thinking of what tools I might need or what I need to do or what's the best solution, I'm not walking this fast. I'm walking slow because where am I rushing to? Rushing to get there and don't know the plan, or you know what I'm saying? And so when we see somebody walking towards Jesus, ain't walking slow, ain't turning back, not confused, we need to follow them. Grab on to them and hold on to them and walk with them as they walk towards Jesus. Now, we're walking towards Jesus. Now, they go and turn around the other way. You got to let go of their hand. Don't follow them away from Jesus. Jesus says, it'll be better for you to have a millstone tied around your neck and be tossed into the sea instead of lead one of his sheep astray. So those people are going to have a harsher condemnation for leading Jesus' sheep astray. And so Paul says, follow me as I follow Christ and imitate me as I imitate Christ. Those are the people we should follow. Those who follow, I see people I love. I see people who I love loving other people and desiring to be like or be with those people, and those people might not be following Jesus. You know, I can't get everybody to follow me. You know, I don't want a huge following me for my glory. There are some things I want, I seek glory in, but I can't, but some things, if you following me, I'm going to take you to Jesus. I'm telling you now, if you following me, we only go on one way, and that's to Jesus. And hopefully if I ever fall down, turn my back on the Lord, I hope that there's no one following me and falling down with me or turn their back on the Lord because they see me doing it. I hope I never get to that point where I'm doing that. But if something ever happened, I don't want to be the cause of somebody's downfall. I don't want to be the reason somebody rejects Jesus Christ. So I try to live a blameless life. I'm not perfect, but the Bible tells me to live a blameless life. Nobody can point at you and say, look, you living in sin right here, mister. You know what I'm saying? That's blameless right there. Not committing sin and hiding your sin from the world because your wife, your husband, your children, your siblings, those are still witnesses. If your husband or wife can point to you and say, this is sin, that's exactly what the Bible says is going to happen. You have to be blameless. No, even behind closed doors, whatever you're doing in the smallest corner, in the darkest room, there's still a witness, and you have to be blameless in front of all of the witnesses who give an account of you. And you will have to give an account. And people will be witnesses to what you did on this earth in this lifetime. But you only get to live one time and die one time. And then you have to be appointed to judgment with God, according to the scriptures. You know? And so, whoever has Jesus, the Lord imputes no sin to him because Jesus is taking away that burden of those sins. The others must pay since they don't need Jesus to pay for them. People who believe that they are living their best life on earth, they probably don't know that there is a better life after this with Jesus. That's probably why they feel like they're living their best life, because they don't know that there's a better life after this one here. Well, the people who know that there's a better life after this life here with Jesus Christ, then we live our lives with Jesus right now. Our best life on this earth. And again, there go some words. I'm not contradicting myself. Words don't mean a whole lot. Maybe the Lord is showing me something. Words don't mean a whole lot when somebody's saying something idle. If there's an action to stand that takes more precedent over it. But I guess when a person's saying something like that, this is my best life, it irritates me. When a person say, I'm never going to have, or you only live once, you know what I'm saying? It irritates me. Yeah, they're ignoring Jesus. They're ignoring, you get a second life with Jesus. You know what I'm saying? They're ignoring that your best life is with Jesus after this life. So maybe God just showing me something about that. Them words, the Lord working on me too about something else. There may be something that God is just revealing to me. And something I got to get, some part of me that I got to get over. There's parts of ourselves that we have to overcome. We overcome things in the world. I've overcome so much stuff in the world. I have overcome so much stuff in the world, but there may be some things within me that I need to overcome as well, before I'm that person who God truly wants me to be. You know what I'm saying? So I'll think about that too. I'll think about the words that irritate me that people say. I have to think about why they irritate me so much, and why they have so much effect on me, why they take a toll on me. You know, I can say, well, it's a lie. I can say it's a sin. You know what I'm saying? If that's the case, that's the case. But some things are not lies. Some things are not sins. Some things are just said in ignorance. They ignore what, you know, else, you know, they ignore the truth, or they just don't say it the way I want them to say it. And I can't be like that. You can't be like that. We can't be like that, because people don't say things the way we want them to be said. Or they say things that they mean in one thing and they saying something different. You know, that can't get to us. You have to die to self. Self cannot be the determining factor on whether somebody should or should not say what they're saying. I got to get up off here, man. 7:15, it's past 7:15. And so, people who believe that people who believe that they're living their best life on earth, they probably don't know that there's a better life after this with Jesus. They probably cannot imagine how life with Jesus would be good, so they reject him now, and he rejects them later on the day of judgment. You hear that? They probably can't imagine some people say, I don't know, I don't want to be floating on no clouds. Somebody I love, but they say, I don't really like fruit. So you talking about eating the fruits from the tree of life. They're like, I don't really like fruit. So how is it going to be good? It's being with Jesus, eating fruits all day long, sitting on the cloud. Man, eyes have not seen and ears have not heard, and it has not entered into a man's imagination or heart or thoughts the good things that God has for those who love him. You can't imagine it. Imagine whatever your best life would be and multiply that times a million. And there you go, what Jesus has for you. We can't imagine. I know what my small, finite mind can't imagine. I know what I can imagine in my small, finite mind. But I know that God's mind is infinite, you know? And so don't let anybody fool you. No one knows the day or the time that the Lord will return. No one knows. So don't say that I died. Don't think that you're going to die and God give you another chance on earth. Once you die, you have to be judged by God, because the Bible says that. When you die, that's it. That's it. We need to tell our people this too. If we want to see them again, if we want to see them, you need to tell them, man, once you die, you judge for your sins. If you don't have Jesus, you must pay for your sins forever. But if you have Jesus, your sins are paid for already. We need to tell people that, man. Tell them that. When Jesus come back, we need to be ready ourselves. We need to help others be ready too. Let's be ready for him. When Jesus returns, let's be ready for him. Waiting patiently for him, obeying willingly, and living faithfully to him. Don't get caught with your pants down. Don't get caught in the midst of something that you shouldn't be doing. Because what if your heart is so bent on, you know what, man, I can do this sin. This ain't nothing. How do you know you say, man, if you can go on out there and premeditate a sin and it don't bother you? How do you know you're saved? You know? So let's be ready. Jesus coming back as a thief in the night. Let's wait patiently, obeying willingly. Ready for him, living faithfully to him. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you, God, that you saw fit to keep me alive, Lord God, until I was surrendered to you, until I was submitted to you. Thank you, Lord, that you have kept me, Lord, all these years. And thank you, God, for revealing things to me. Lord, I need you to reveal some more things to me, God. When I get discouraged, when I get disappointed, God, when I get disoriented, God, when I feel like I'm distracted, Lord, God, I need you to show me, God, the plans that you have for me so that I can stay on track, so I can get back on track of them all, Lord, God, so that I can continue on the right track without slowing down, without being confused, without wondering if I'm going the right way, Lord, without wondering what's down the road. Help me to stay on the right track, to be on the right track, and to continue going on the right track, Lord. Reveal your plans to me, God, that give me hope. Reveal your plans to us that give us hope. And the ones that strengthen our faith in you. Give us plans and a revelation that strengthen our faith in you, God, so that we can continue living for you, God. So we only get one life, God. Help us to live this one life for you so that we may have eternal life with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, that's it for Morning Cup of Jesus. If the Lord is willing, we're going to be right back here tomorrow morning around the same time. Amen. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. God bless you. Enjoy your day. I'm walking.